said good day, sir!
Hello, everybody, and welcome back here to the D of the Fence, as I am Toby One, joined here by Doka Dota, coming in for our second and last series of the night. Ninjas in Pajamas up against Vega Squadron, their doubleheader. They went 1-1 in their earlier game up against Arcade Power Rangers, Esport Gaming, of all epicness of long names. and now up against Vega Squadron. A lot easier, a lot more efficient, a lot stronger killers. But we'll see how they go in tonight's game.
And this is definitely going to be the tougher of the two matchups that they get tonight. Vega Squadron, even though since ESL 1 New York, they've not been on that same kind of, you know, winning streak, the great long strides they've had. Their drafts have been a little bit off. I don't know, they're just not hitting the right notes right now.
Give them time.
But I feel like this is not just on them, but a lot of the other teams out there have become stronger. You know, since ESL 1 New York, we've seen teams like Alliance especially just really get into the swing of things and really kind of get into this patch as well, because you've got to give it to some teams that know how to really draft into the new patches. I know Gorgon, he released an article straight after TI5 about Na'Vi, and one of their greatest strengths was that they don't really deviate too much from stuff. They innovate a little bit at the start of new patches, but they keep what they had in the previous patch the same. They don't come out with flashy new heroes like, you know, Winter Wyvern was the one hero that they really did touch from the new patch. But Vega seems like the same thing. They keep the same old, Pasha, Ember Spirit, Gyrocopter. They're like the Tiny Wisp, and they're like Mag on things like Clockwork and Broodmother.
I love how you actually say Strength and Na'Vi in the same sentence.
Hey now.
It's...
Don't break my heart, Toby.
I will break it. You should be used to it by now. If you're a Na'Vi fan, it's been broken multiple times in just a couple of weeks. I can agree with you. Like Vega, like they, I want to call them a one trick pony. They're like a four trick pony, where they got a lot of different things they can work with. As you said, like you got that brood, you got that clock, you got that offlay like Mag. Like you know what he's gonna be playing. You know what Pasha solo, no one seamer, are kind of working towards every time. But that's, as we've also seen in previous like TIs. Like if we look back at TI3 for example, it was a huge downside. Which was TI3, TI4.
For who?
TI4, for Alliance, like when you knew like they were just they were Wisp and Prophet. You ban those two heroes, and you're completely done. Like what are you meant to do against them? Like what are they meant to do now? Because they're too easy to read, and that was always one of those big problems as a team. You got to try and be diverse. You got to try and like that's what I liked most about last night's games with Alliance, where this Queen of Pain picked up, and then all of a sudden, it's a fourth position. You're like, wait, what the hey? Like, how is this meant to work? And they make it work. To be innovative is the only way you win tournaments, not just come in with the set meta. Normally, it's the team who brings that consistent meta without the diversity. Like LGD, we remember their run. Like, the most recent one was CDEC. Like, they came in with a set draft and a set execution. That they became so predictable that EG knew they were going to win when they hit the grand final. Because they worked them out from the time. And that's one of those things where I will always promote diversity over stability in a way.
For sure. And we used to see this a ton from Vega Squadron in their infancy and teams like Moscow 5 and Screen Squad. These CIS teams, they used to love running the Tusk, the aggressive Trilands, the Night Stalkers, things like that. And throughout tournaments like Gigabyte Challenge, MSI Dragon Battle, they'd win game after game after game, get to the grand final, and then they'd struggle. They'd hit that barrier where there'd be someone like Scary Faces or Power Rangers, someone who had that little bit of flair, you know, about them. That last pick, Huskar, the scary little vengeful spirit one roll hero that they pull out from time to time. Speaking of scary heroes though, Toby, Doombringer for Vega.
Yeah.
We've been avoiding this for a little while, but we've got to look at this now.
When you ban out the Broodmother and the Darkseer in the first two, you are so heavily trying to shut down Mag that it's ridiculous. And then Vega are like, well, okay, we're up against NiP. We don't want to give him Wisp because it's NiP. You never want to play with that kind of fire. And you don't want to give him Tuskar, even though Unison Farm wasn't able to perfectly hit his shards in the earlier games tonight. He's still got to be feared like when that Tuskar gets picked up. They got a lot to work with him. But then Vega, like they get the dream. Like with these bans, NiP, whenever you have second pick, you gotta ban out the Doom. And they had second pick. They didn't ban out the Doom. The Doom comes through. Wyvern Ancient Apparition is NIP's answer to this. Like, the AA is normally the counter to the Doombringer as far as stopping that regeneration during the fights. But when you get something like a TA and a Dazzle in there, the Doom can just sit back, keep farming up, and the TA should gain enough momentum that you can just win the mid game and let the Doom kick in a little bit later on. But the Venno pickup, this is just a... This for me almost feels like NIP are trying to find an answer to the exact thing I was bringing up, like the fact that TA is going to get momentum. Venno can stop this.
All three of these heroes here are very good at dealing with Doom, Dazzle, and TA so far. Because against Doom, you either want that big burst damage nuke just to go through Scorched Earth and kill him off, or you want something that stops the sustain. And if you can stop other heroes' sustained heal and damage coming out as well, the TA's Refraction, Dazzle's Shadow Wave, Wyvern, AA, and Venomance are all very good at that.
The only issue is they're also fragile.
They're very good at stopping blink daggers as well. So if Doom and TA wanted to go for blinks, and I was thinking here NIP maybe had to go for the Slaughter block pick against Vega, because Slaughter is such a great hero, but by picking Venomancer, it's really deterring that tertiary blink hero. And they're actually going to go for Clockwork. So it looks like Pasha Doom, no one on the TA mid, and Mad Clockwork. So they've moved the Doom around, which is, you know, he's a versatile hero. They're not really locking him into any one role. But that's really something the Venomancer pick has done.
It's almost like Vega's looking at this game going, okay, we need to have some initiation. We plan for the mid game. As long as we just avoid NIP in the early stages, we're going to be okay. Like NIP, like they don't have... For the
trees. They've got no stuns.
Yeah. And they're also so fragile. You're running three intel heroes and a weak Agi hero.
They're just going like full reaction. If Vega Squadron dive or initiate, everybody piles in from NIP, I think is the plan here.
There's the Spectre ban. Vega's just like, okay. If this is meant to be a 4 protect 1 or a 4 slash split push 1, it's fairly dangerous. This is actually almost one of these AM games for NIP.
I think they have to go for something more aggressive. Something with a ton of stuns. Like Centaur is the thing that comes to mind initially for me.
You can't run a number one position stun. Like, you don't have the pushing power to finish the game in time. You need someone who's stronger to push and fight. The funny thing is, I'm thinking of a Lashrak.
I think you've got tons of pushing power between Furion and Venomancer, especially like after 15 minutes. You want someone, like you said, who, you know, Vega wanted the initiation, but now NIP wants it too. They need someone who can jump in and start.
You know what I'd love? I'd love a Dro Ranger. I just think a Dro Ranger would work so beautifully in this one. Gives you a push, gives you a team fight, and you're running four range heroes already. You could actually get so much more out of the lane than the Nature's Prophet could become a big damage dealer.
Then I guess you just let Vega come to you.
Yeah.
And you turn the fight on them.
Exactly that. Like, eventually, like, you're gonna be split pushing. So if Vega come to you, you go elsewhere. Like, Dro can push down tier 1 towers by herself. Venno can do the same kind of thing, just establish control, and then Prophet moves across the map. The Wyvern and the AA, they just stack up. The farms are quite easy to do when you've got, like, Venomancer or even Wyvern, like, Splinter Blast, Treants. Like, you can work through stacks as well. Yeah, that's actually where my brain is going to go. But knowing NIP, they probably wouldn't do that. They would probably look into something more like a Lunar pickup as their final one. The one hero that could just stand their ground, pump out a huge amount of damage. You still get that aura buff up, so when they want to push, like a Lunar, AA, Wyvern, and then Prophet TP's in as well, you're going to take out a tower. Like, it can't be stopped.
Sure. Well, what are Vega looking for? Secondary support? There's one thing that we haven't pointed out here, which is the potential for a Doom 4 role, but going greedy here is like the 1% play. It's not likely. So it's going to be like secondary support, a Witch Doctor.
Well, so you actually want to see that Doom in the 1 position?
It's going to be Pasha Doom, I'm not like 90% sure.
I was starting to question it a little bit now.
Maybe the 1% play does come into...
But this is
coming to the game.
This is so weird. Because when you run, because you're running so much melee up against a Venomancer, and TA, we kind of want to counter as melee, even if you do have Sideblade bonuses. Wraith King, Clock, and Doom. Like, Wraith King and Clockwork won't be able to move if they get hit by either Gale or Nova or both. You can sprout control in a way on some of these guys. The Doombringer will have movement speed, but a lot of this will also be taken away from the Venomancer, by the Venomancer. I'm worried that Vega are just going to get kited by NIP. That's what I'm looking at. And that's why I actually think the draw is even a better pickup now, because then you got Gus to push them back.
That's the biggest issue I have with Wraith King maybe going into the one role.
Yeah, I but what do you want to do? Like, you put him into a second position role? Like, you can get away with running Wraith King in the lane for the first... Like, you do actually... It's almost what I'll... Actually, yeah, it's what Alliance did, where they gave the Queen of Pain farm in the mid lane, on the safe lane. So you give him the first two, three waves. The Doomring is just inside the jungle doing his own thing at that point. And then rotates down, Wraith King moves into the jungle. He can have Vampiric Aura by that point, and probably a stun, and that should be enough for him to be self-sufficient inside the jungle. And then he can find the level. So you almost run this... you start him off as a fourth position playing a one position, and then you rotate, you flip them.
Why not be taking a sweet time with F's pick?
They
do go for... go for a little agi hero that can skitter around, but it's not the Drow Ranger. Time-lapsing bug. Hey, look. It's solo in the four-roll Doom. I'm glad I pointed it out, but I'm kind of regretting I said it's the 1% play and it actually comes out and happens. That's interesting from Vega, actually.
It's interesting from NiP, they pick a Weaver into a Doombringer. Like, if this Weaver is able to get a Lincoln Sphere, then he's going to have a great time. Because there's almost nothing that can control him apart from Doom. Doom is the critical thing that Era has to avoid in all fights. But getting a Lincoln's isn't enough. He needs to be able to get the damage to go along with that Lincoln's.
I wonder, actually, since the sort of build-up for Desolator got a lot cheaper, we've seen Templar Assassin go Deso before going Blink, and we used to see the Phase Boots Drums Yasha build on TA so often. I wonder if on the Weaver it's worth going Desolator first as well. Because it gives you so much farming and push potential that it ramps up your farm that much more than if you go for like the Deso almost rush after like the Ring of Aquila, that you can go into the Lincoln's, you know, at the same speed as rushing a Lincoln's almost.
Uproot
and after that. This aggro.
Yep.
Nah.
Yep. Why not? If that's a Wraith King on the safe lane, what do you have to worry about? Seal Kid comes down, gives you extra damage, he'll harass him straight out of the lane. You can get away with running a dual lane. Limp goes to the mid with Hanskin. Zone out that Templar Assassin.
And a Jungle Doom that does nothing.
Yeah. Like, what's he going to do? Rotate over? Like, he devours a tree very early on. That's nice for him. That's some easy money. But, yeah, NiP could completely crush this offlane, bringing both Sealgid as well as Hanskin down south. You're going to force the Doom to stay in the lane. You're going to make it so Wraith King can't really achieve much.
Like we saw Silence Wraith King do last night. Against Alliance.
Yeah.
Since the Swedes know how to deal with Wraith King. They've been trained in the ways of anti-Wraith King play.
It's like a Swedish camp for Dota. It's called Dreamhack.
It's like all the CIS and Russian teams got trained how to play Broodmother. All the Alliance teams have been trained how to play against Wraith King.
Doom also gets the Bounty Rune. So they are giving a little of extra effort into solo as this Doombringer. But this dual offlane slash... even Hans, he's blocking the pull points. So they're going to block... Like, it's actually a little bit further up. So this ward, I don't believe it blocks the camp on the right. Okay, I take it back. I'm wrong. That is on the magic bush. Mm-hmm. I wasn't certain. Even though I can see it, the bush underneath it. I always thought it was a little bit lower.
The magic bush.
Yeah.
Boots first on TA. So we're not going to see any early First Bloodsmen, I don't think.
No, but then again, does Boots really count when you've got that Arctic Burn and you get Galed with Poison Sting from TV? Limp? No early blood. That's the 1% kill. There's going to be no one dying. He'll tick out in just a moment. Hanskin ensures the kill. He may die to that attack from the tower. No, he'll survive. Triggers a salve. The creep won't be able to catch up to him in time, even though the creep does have more movement speed than Hanskin.
I thought the Dazzle would TP in.
He doesn't have a TP. How could a Dazzle prepare for that, really? Like, you want to have a TP at level 1 as a Dazzle?
Yep.
You probably should.
But. Yep.
But instead, they're trying to go for the dual lane of their own. Wraith King, as well as this Dazzle. They can get rid of these treants pretty quickly. The harassment as well from Yunsen Farm becomes negligible, primarily because you've got that heal from Seema. So Pasha's able to farm up quite easily. But it makes it almost a suicide lay on the bottom for Mag.
It's getting zoned out so heavily.
But he still managed to find level 2.5. Like, that's still pretty damn good. He just won't find any CS to go with these levels, but... like, you're never really going to complain about that when you're a clockwork, right?
Seal kid. It's time to trade hits. Era can zip himself over there with Shikuchi, no questions asked.
He's just holding back on the chilling touch. Like, he threw it on a vortex instead. It's almost the same amount of mana.
The Dazzle has a TP now. He knows what's up.
Just wait for that gank. No one's having a real hard time. He's only got one camp, and like this is the bread and butter for the TA. It's the same kind of thing with the ESF advantage. You just want to be able to stack this camp, and then you flash farm it with side blades, in this case of the Templar Assassin. But you don't really have that opportunity, because Huntkin is camping it. So TA is spending more time battling up against a Winter Wyvern who has level 2 so he can just Cold Embrace, while Limp is getting free levels as well as CS. Like, he's 14-1 up against a 6-0 Templar Assassin.
Look at no one.
What is he? He's really... okay, maybe we should look towards top lane. You know some farmers up here. There's three heroes all around him. So they're able to find that kill with Solo coming to join them. So this Prophet will end up dying, but we still have to look at him in like an offlaner. No one is now a full level behind that of the Venomancer.
Yeah, he's been... It's like in the offlane, you know, when the support and the offlaner battle out across away from the creep wave. That's what no one has been doing. He's just been trying to battle against Hanskin and force him away from this lane.
But this isn't going to work. Like, Limp's got level...
Is he dead again now?
Yeah, he's... Okay, he's got Invis. They got the Sentry Wars down. No one gets rid of it pretty quickly, but... okay, he'll end up dropping. The Clockwork died in the bottom lane to the Weaver. So Eero was able to finally find that aggression he was looking for. And Solo comes into the middle lane. He's trying to go here on Limp, but Huntskin can't slow him down. These Plague Wards are keeping at least the Poison Sting on him, but with that Scorched Earth level 2, okay, now you start to see it disappearing. Limp needs to keep that slow on Solo to get away, and Seal Kid rotates over as well. The Vortexes are down. Solo's massively slowed up. He's got no ability to get away apart from that standard walk, but the bright side for him is he's got support around the corner. So NiP break off the chase.
I'm getting so much value on this bottom lane, though. Look at this.
The power of Prophet.
TP's in, treants up, and Era spams into that little tier 1 tower.
It's what we see time and time again from Nature's Prophet. And Vega, they have to do something about this. That's the reason why Solo is rotating down. His mana isn't really great. He doesn't have Scorched Earth available. Era is actually not able to get the last hit on the tower, and Solo, all he's got is this Centaur Stomp. Seema's pretty damn low, so Era runs through. Solo doesn't go for the stun because he wants to go in for that Scorched Earth, and he'll do so. And Seema, the Weaver Bug, is actually going to find the kill. Solo, he's losing his armor. He already had Jackal to begin with. So it's a double kill now here on the bottom lane going the way of NiP. The TP forward from Unison Farm unsuccessful because of the Cog defense. But this is all happening while Limp is pushing the mid lane so heavily that no one can't find any farm. Your safe lane has now been trashed. And the only advantage is a hero who's going to be kited in the later game, farming top lane, aka Wraith King. Help me be optimistic, Durka. So right now, I'm so pessimistic.
I'm honestly starting to think of outs here for Vega. Because one of the biggest ones is obviously when you look at the Templar Assassin, a way to get back into the game is clear through Ancients, going to take a sneaky Roshan farm in the jungle. But the way that NiP are able to just encroach into this Radiant jungle without really caring too much, the Plague Wards give them perfect vision of everything.
Yep.
They see Solo coming across, they know the TA's mid, they've got mid lane pushing in, there are no stacks, there's no jungle camps, you can't go, like you said early on, the Wyvern was there, you can't go and flash farm that medium camp stack at all. And then Weaver is down here alone, farming with impunity, not really caring at all about anything.
They really need to just, like... I don't even want to say they have to be aggressive.
They just need Doom to hit level 6. I think that is...
yeah, agreed.
...the biggest factor. They need Solo to just farm the jungle, ignore everything, get level 6, go and kill the Weaver, something like that.
Good luck farming the jungle. Like, you're being watched. The Dire Observer Ward's already so aggressive. Your mid-tier 1 tower's being attacked that Solo has to keep looking behind himself. And we're talking about what was meant to be a fourth position for Vega. acting like a one position. Right? The ability for him to stop this push. Now he's gonna get sprouted. TP straight back out again. There's no curse, there's no stuns. So he will end up surviving.
The one big weakness of NIP's draft.
He's TPing quickly. I'll call. Oh, wait, no.
They have
cold feet duration is just way too damn long.
So how do they deal with that?
How do you deal with it? You get Yule Scepters. You get other cheaper forms of control.
So Yule's on Venno, I guess?
That would be where I'd go with it. You could...
It does deviate from the normal kind of Midas into Ags build, though.
It does. And Ags is such a good item in this game, you're right. It's... Hey, you just get Curse over on Hunskin, that's the other way. You want a great lockdown, he's the one to do it.
But or you just ramp up your damage enough to make the TPs useless. Get Desolators, get Orchids.
Era's killing Pasha. He might actually have to level up his ulti. Yeah, he does. He levels up Reincarnation, so Era will get through him. Solo's trapped inside the Sprout as Hanskin on 32 life will cold embrace himself up, staying on the tree line. He can't get down from here, however, so they deal with Unison Farm, and this is what Vega needed. NIP to make a mistake. Mag will jump up, and he can't get down.
Okay. He's up there until he gets 75 mana, I guess. But with Limp up on top lane, they didn't have a really...
Era wants him.
Oh.
Era actually cuts through a little bit, but not enough. Mag can use that Tango to cut back in if he wants to. He can cog burn Era back as well if he... Yeah, do it. Yep, there we go. So Era's pushed back a little bit. Mag still hasn't used this Tango, and there's the bottle charges from no one. No stun. He TP's back out to safety. But that's actually the dream for Vega. You've got so much space that Doom's now almost level 6. The TA getting involved, finding a kill, up to level 7, getting money, even more important. Your tier 1 tower has gone in the middle lane, and Seema is now just going to have to TP out the top. Like he can't fight here. He's just trying to do the push as much as he can and then TP out.
Stop me.
It's perfect.
Limp is bypassing Midas going, Doom at mid. Solo's found Seal Kid, but I don't know if...
He doesn't have enough damage.
Him. It's called Embrace, right?
Yep. The Clockwork Rocket wasn't enough chip damage either. Okay. But okay, Mag! He really wants that. He gets it. Actually helps ensure the kill. Nature's Prophet gets a kill in the meantime. That's down the bottom lane with the help of Era. But Solo, he's still so close to this mid tower. He's going to TP out, run for the Hanskin. But Venomant throws down the Plague Ward. They find the kill. And that's a little overextension. Mag's also on the run. Unison Farm's trying to chase it down. With the Wrath of Nature, a bonus damage they also got. Like, that's what made that work so well. You just weren't ready for the level 6 of Nature's Prophet. And Era's...
He's still down here doing his thing.
Like, he's not being stopped. Like, he's 50 for 14 as far as the CS goes. The net worth, he's not the highest. That does belong to the Venomancer. But Era's still... Like, it's the Lincoln Sphere build time. What was the old, like the old timings on the safe lane Weaver, like you're looking with all like the treads and everything else you'd have to buy. You'd be looking at 22 minutes for the Lincoln Sphere and then like 28 minutes for the Desolator. Because like Black was one of also the first people over in Europe that started doing it without any kind of boots over on the Weaver. This is actually back in Warcraft 3 Dota. Era's following the same suit. You get all your movement speed from Shikuchi. So you just get your regeneration from your Ring of Aquila, your Perseverance, the burst regen from Wand.
You cut like 5 minutes off, honestly.
Yep.
You can go for sort of the 16-minute Lincoln Sphere, and then into maybe the 21 Desolator, something like that. Especially now, Desolator is so much cheaper. He still goes for the brand boots, though.
So he's not going to complete the treads. It's not bad movement speed. But when you've got the regeneration he's already got, Shikuchi's not that expensive when you get attacked. So you can be a little bit more liberal with its use. Clockwork, hook shots up, catching out Seal Kid. Perfect hook shot in. The Cold Feet's gonna seal up Mag for a moment, but Seal Kid's already gonna drop. Or will he? He goes down. They doom over on Unison Farm, so he can't help out Seal Kid. And Mag's too far away, so Unison Farm will drop. The TA died over near the Radiant Ancients, and yeah. Okay, Seal Kid will actually survive, even though he was the first one being initiated on.
They went for the bigger kill, but look at this. Limp kills the Templar Assassin, and now they steal the Ancient Stacks from Vega.
This is so brutal.
I don't know how they can come in here and stop it. Without Hookshot, without Reincarnation, there's no real...
No Doom.
There's nothing.
No Scorched Earth. You even triggered your Drum Charge over on the Doombringer.
And now Seal Kid hits level 6 as well. That's huge. Winter Wyvern has Curse. They've used the Ice Blast. Initial one, aiming down at bot. They were looking for Pasha. Yeah. It wasn't far. Oh, is he? Whoa.
Yeah. Hey, Jonas.
Yeah, if that Ice Blast actually connected, then that was an easy kill if that worked.
But this is the TA's way back in. Just gone down the drain. NiP, great movements.
If she got that, it would have been the Mithril Hammer. It would have been the start of getting into that Desolator. Now she's going to be stacking over like Satyrs, which is being watched as well by NiP. This Observer Ward is still up. It's gone through the full duration. So you've actually got a very deep ward 12 minutes in that's managed to finish a full duration. Vega, don't remove it. Just tells you how much information NiP has had.
Yeah. And this is all from the first 6 or 7 minutes where they could just push past the tier 1 mid behind the Templar Assassin.
Hookshot up by Mag. As she bumps into a range creep, so they can kill him here. Just turn and throw the Ice Blast Seal Kit if he wants to. The Cold Feast trapped him in one position. So yeah, here it comes, Mag. Okay, that took a little bit too long. Hans can now ask the Cold Embrace himself up. Vega realized it is, however, a level 6 Winter Wyvern, so they don't want to commit too heavily because there is going to be the curse, but they commit too heavily! Pasha gets Ice Head, the Splinter Blast will fly out as well. Limp, well, there's no ultimate from him, but Pasha's going to go down. The reincarnation will break from this. Mag TPing out. They all just so slow because of that reincarnation from Wraith King, but Wraith King is worse for him. This ult is going to go on cooldown once again. Limp actually able to blink himself forward. Doesn't finish up the axe. It's a perfect blink into a Gale. Helping to ensure the kill over on the Wraith King as well as the Dazzle. And now they push into the tier 2 tower. Blink Dagger instead of Ags. Like, he could actually finish the Ags by now.
On Limp. Yeah, I was wondering. He saved up 2,000 gold.
Solo.
Oh God.
Solo YOLO. Jumps in behind. Wants to start off with that Doom. At least able to keep Era out of this fight. But he dies almost instantly after. Mag with a rocket helps to get another kill. No one, he's just so injured. That Nova, that poison Nova of Limp, the heal will be there from Seaman to keep no one alive. The poison sting isn't enough to get the kill on him. Or actually, it shouldn't be, yeah, it won't be enough.
And Era's fine, he just walks it off.
Yeah. And now he can also pick up the ultimate orb. That Doom won't have the anywhere near the same effect next time.
Oh, man.
But you actually fought into NiP when they had Poison Nova off cooldown. We already talked about the problem of Vega getting kited, but you willingly fought into that to try and defend the tier 2, which you still lost.
And now it's level 2.
It was denied,
well,
however, so that's not bad.
The biggest thing is as well, like, okay, that was NiP using all of their ultimates, but that wasn't using all of their ultimates at once. That was a Winter's Curse, 5 seconds later, well, no, sorry, it started off with an Ice Blast onto Clockwork,
yep.
Then 5 seconds later, Winter's Curse.
The Ice Blast missed as well.
Then 5 seconds later, Poison Nova. If NiP get a similar fight again with, you know, the synergy between all of their spells all at once, that's Vega getting wiped.
Yep.
Off the face of the map.
Seal Kid, well, he's going to find an opening over on no one, and Era's just jumping forward. Wait for that Nature's Prophet and TP himself forward. Not going to happen. Just throws out the Wrath of Nature. The Cold Feet don't latch either. And Pasha's just trying to get rid of this bug so he can stop having that negative armor. The Gale will connect, the Ice Blast coming in too, and oh!
He Houdini.
Got, no, that's actually hilarious. He didn't take the damage from the Frost
Blast. Is he still
dead? He got chilled up, but if he actually got hit by the impact and not the flight, he would be dead right now.
Yep. The trail hit him. The shatter effect was on, but that nuke damage just wasn't there. Oh, sure. And count your lucky stars.
Feel robbed. That's what it should be right now for Seal Kid. That looked like it was in the bag.
No one gets his first Mithril Hammer. I don't know where you go from Vega, as Vega from here. Seema, middle lane.
Just keep, okay.
Hey.
Okay.
Winter's Curse, okay.
That's a thing.
Kills the Dazzle.
With the Dazzle down, I'm actually wondering if, like, you can't do Roshan. Because that's what NiP will want. Like, you're about to finish up a Lincoln Sphere over on Era. If you can get a little bit of extra insurance on a core by getting that Aegis to the Immortal, like, you're going to be looking really sick, really sweet for the future. Limp is dead. That's actually a huge pick off. Mag hookshotted himself down to ensure the control. And he gets himself 771 gold for that, not to mention the share. Solo did have to commit his ulti for it. You lose your Templar Assassin at the same time.
Yeah,
so
exactly. Like, it's a big kill for Vega taking out the Venomancer, but equally shutting down this Templar Assassin is great for NiP. And then it's also the additional bonus you get. the fact that the jungle is all theirs. So you look at where Vega is standing right now. Solo is in the dire jungle, Mag is farming top, but where's your Wraith King? Middle lane, being forced back by a solo Winter Wyvern. He's running away from the creep wave because he doesn't feel safe here. The rest of NiP are just so threatening from their aggressive position right now.
But the funny thing is, like, the big playmakers have their levels and items. Like, you're about to get level 11 on both Clock as well as the Doombringer. Clock's finished his 4-star, so he can engage and then disengage. This buys them space, and the Doom is still running a level 4 Devour. Like, you're getting more and more money into this Doombringer. And I'm interested to see what he now does with the 1500 gold, about to become like 1700 gold, that he's got on this Doom. Like, where do you go from here if you're solo? The Aghanim's got pretty well nerfed, so you're not wanting to go into that kind of build. Do you try and get, what, survivability? Do you try and find damage? Do you think, like, what's your play?
Like, that's the question. Like, does he aim short-term and go for a Blink Dagger just to win the next couple of team fights and know that he can doom up the Venomancer or something like that in the back and jump in?
Are you thinking long-term as Midas?
No, I think long-term is Plate Mail into Shivas. Go for the Aura build.
Okay. So you end up having both Shivas as well as Assault Cuirass on him at the end of the day?
Like, maybe even... I guess he doesn't have Bassy, so Vlad's isn't going to be an option, but Plate Mail is going to be good, but the fact he's now saved up 1900 makes me think it's going to be the Blink.
You know what actually makes me think it's going to be? If he can get enough space to do it, he just becomes that damage dealer. He ends up getting something like a Radiance build over on the Doombringer. It's not bad up against how weak NiP is.
Yeah, and mischance. Like, you look at their ultimates on NiP, sure enough, they rely on them, but a lot of it is physical damage.
Blink forward. Actually misses the Gale. The Nova's going to connect. Someone's going to finish up this tower. It will actually be done by the Catapult. The Solo has to be cursed up, but the Doom is over on Limp, and he's ticking down from this. The Hawk shot perfectly, isolating Hunskin. Will they end up denying up Limp? He's so low. Seal Kid's walking straight past him. Seal Kid, okay, Limp survives. Barely. The Templar Assassin will die. Mag force-stopping himself up. He really wants this kill over on the Wyvern, and he is going to claim it, but he'll lose his life for that kill.
That started awfully for Ninjas in Pajamas, but it's going to end with, what, three heroes dead? Solo's getting chased down with no Scorched Earth.
Ira doesn't have bugs. The Lincoln's going to block the attack from the Wraith King.
Oh, there's no mana for Ice Blast. That's what I was looking for. The Ice Blast over the top.
Hang on. If he can actually pop a level here and get himself up with a stat point. Does that bring him in range? Sorry, too late. Solo is back. He's fine.
What is Jonas building? He bought a 4-staff and now he's got an ogre club.
He's probably thinking, wow.
Aghanim's would be point booster. Halberd wouldn't be bad here against the Wraith King and TA, because neither of them is close, nor do they want to go BKB.
I've made the mistake before of, it's actually the Staff Wizard, it's the Aghanim. I've made the mistake before as well of wondering, like, if it's point, like, it should be a point booster, right? If you're going to go Aghanim Sept, it's the best value for points. But it's become more of a trend in Europe where you start with Yoga Club. I don't know why. I can't think of a really logical reason for it. But it's been happening more and more.
Guess what? You get 190 HP from Yoga Club. A bit of HP regen.
Oh, they're coming. There's a Blink Dagger Wraith King. If they can actually get this kill on the Venomancer before the fight begins, yeah, you can keep doing the math on that one till the cows come home, but it's not stopping what people are doing. Pasha jumps forward, the Lincoln Sphere. Wow, Ira actually gave it over to Limp, so he didn't get stunned by the Wraith King hit, and that allows Limp to blink forward. Hits Pasha with the Nova. He's gonna die here. The curse is over on Solo. The Ice Blast flies in, ensures the first kill on the Doombringer as Wraith King blinks himself away to safety. The hook shot from Mag, he's coming in as well, four-stopping out. You know, some farm,
Blink
puts
dodge.
Himself out to safety there. And it's now Pasha. Well, there's your TP out to safety.
Stun him!
He's
stun
actually
him!
Nope, they don't. Oh, they can't. Wait. There's nothing.
They have no stuns. Doom went for Shadow Blade. Wraith King went for Blink. So they've gone for relatively early game focused items to win them team fights. The Clockwork has gone back for a Midas. And this just screams
trouble.
Lack of synergy in the team.
I actually love that I can be completely wrong with the prof. Like, yeah, he's got his 4-staff, he's got his staff wizardry as well. That's the fact you get a 4-staff as well this early on. Something against the clockwork, everything gets delayed.
I mean, he had the force before and then went for the Ogre Club.
Yeah.
But yeah, whatever.
It's
Ogre Club just it does not mathematically make sense.
Maybe it's meant to be the mind games.
I'm gonna go for an Ogre Club item.
Is he going for a BKB? Nice hookshot. Mag finding Hanskin in the middle of the open. As Hanskin Arctic burns himself away, Mag's gonna force off again. This is deja vu. It's the same place, the same location, the same bad time. Seema has to shallow grave Mag up, but Hanskin, he's got something better, a cold embrace, and Mag still knows he's dead. He can't cogburn anyone. Seema will end up dying to limp. And now it was 8-18 in favor of NiP. The battle continues.
Is this the same team we just saw play against Power Rangers?
Yeah, but it's also the same situation. Like, they've just got so much to work with. The coordination isn't perfect from NiP. So I still feel like this is like game number one that they had up against Power Rangers. It's the fact that Vega just keep going for uneven traits. Like, they're going ham. Like, look at Sol. He's not going to stop. Like, he's going to try and kill off Unison Farm here. Won't care if there's support around the corner. Yep. Doom. Blink forward from Limp. They're ready for it, but there's your curse, so Sol's going to end up dying.
And Jonas doesn't die because of Cold Embrace.
Yep. He still buys up his items just in case. Yeah, he doesn't take enough damage. But this is just what... It's the opportunities. The difference is between, I think, this game and what happened with the previous one is the fact that NiP are capitalizing more on the situations they're given. Like, the chances which Vega give them. They're finding the better trade-offs. There's no horrible team fights in clustered areas in front of the Roshan pit. It's not like that. They're actually able to kite properly, and their draft really enables them to do so.
Kiting without stuns.
It's the dream. The age of the slow is upon us.
Yep. Vega.
That's actually still the reason why I think Jakiro is amazing. He's got slow and stun. And good line damage as well.
A ton of them, yeah.
Yep. There goes the tower. Aghanim is up for Unison Farm.
And Vega don't even get the trade. They were trying to push into bot tier 1 with Pasha, but the Wraith King with Blink just doesn't do enough damage. So the plan here for Vega is to find a target, kill them, and get the numbers advantage as early on as they possibly can. They've got TA Dessa with a crit and hit from Meld, Blink, Shadow Blade, Wraith King, and Doom, and then a Force Staff and Hookshot from Mag's Clockwork as well.
Unison Farm, this is going to be big if Mag can get the Hookshot.
They just need vision. Like, that is the one thing that Vega are lacking right now to win a team fight and potentially drag themselves back in this game.
TA Traps and Clockwork Rocket.
Yeah, but
path of vision is there.
They give you small amounts of vision onto like one target. What you need is sort of overruling vision of seeing where NiP is set up, because knowing where the AA is often gives you the intel of knowing where the Wyvern is without actually seeing him, because you know they're not going to be directly next to each other. Usually they're sort of offset, and they'll be coming in from two different angles into the team fight. So knowing where one of those targets is gives you, like fully knowing where one of them is, gives you a much better time.
Solo.
Oh, that's the curse again.
He got hit by the Gale, and I think he realized he was dead. But the other option is, by the way, we just saw Prophet, or we just didn't see Prophet. Clockwork just picked up the Prophet next to the Radiant Ancients. Really big for him as well as no one, because now no one has both the Ogre Club and the Mithril Hammer into the BKB, or he just says screw it, he buys Blink Dagger. Of course, Unbridled Aggression. But the fact that the Doom, like, potentially Solo could have tried to walk himself to the tree line and then TP out, but because he TP'd out straight away, he doesn't force the Wyvern to burn a Sentry Ward and ends up just dying. He burns the curse, that's all.
Just the curse.
Well, it's not really that much. Like, NIPs, the fights between, like the moments when he needs curse, like, it's over 2 minutes almost every time.
Era's got his Deso.
And he does. This Weaver, it's 25 minutes in. The funny thing is, like, the timing is still roughly what I was saying before. Like, it's the 22 to 28 minutes. That heal, Seema. I think he just saved his Wraith King from a world of hurt, but he's going to die himself. Shallow Grave TP. Oh, wait. Era's got no stun. You know, I think at this point, it's almost worthwhile getting yourself, like, value Yule Scepters over on, like, your other cores. There's no curse, so Mag will also TP out. Yeah, you got to get some Yule Scepters. Just anything which can give you an interrupt.
Monkey
the Doombringer also
bashes.
Just killed Ancient Apparition in the mid lane. Solo keeps the hunting going. Farms up the lane, overstays his welcome. He's got Shadow Blade in 2 seconds, and there's no stuns. Solo will escape.
And then look, another one. Templar TP's out.
This is so stupid.
Vega know. They know how to escape.
They need stuns. They need disables. You got a Venomancer building into a refresh room. Okay, if you're not going to go stuns and disables, if you're actually just going to push this, then... Wait, is this a refresh room? No, this will be another Lincoln's for Limp. This has to be a Lincoln Sphere. Right?
I'm not sure. I think both have their merits.
I'm not so certain about the refresher orb, though, because you're still going to... like, once you hit level 16, you got a 1 minute cooldown in your ultimate, and you can't stack Nova. So, yeah, that doesn't make a lot of sense. But what else would you build with the Perseverance?
Like, I think the Lincoln's value does override the override the refresher one. For what you're saying, you know, the lack of stuns from Vega just makes it so much more worthwhile.
You could get really, like, smart and pick up something like a Lotus Orb and try and return the Doom.
Lincoln's is more valuable
than a Lotus. It really is.
It's like stopping the Doom is better than reflecting the Doom. Because once he throws his ulti, it's like, well, whatever. I've got Scorched Earth. I basically negate my entire Doom duration anyway.
Yeah. The way the Doom will initiate, he's just like, oh, Scorched Earth bump. It's Yeah. There's no point to reflect it.
I think the power from the refresher would be so niche in the fact that when Vega goes for a team fight, it would require NiP to miss out on their big wombo combo for refresher to be useful. So let's say they Winter's Curse two targets, they get the poison over onto five, mm-hmm. but three of the guys from Vega run away, the heal in base, and then they re-engage. And then if Vega can take a fight 3v3 or whatever it is, what trade-off they get, if they have another poison over then, NiP kill the remaining three and they just push into base. And that's where the strength of refresher comes in. But Lincoln's Sphere would just give them that, you know, straight away, we're just going to win the initial team fight.
Yeah. Yeah, it really would, man. So, the Lincoln's Veno means solo's life becomes even harder. But with this Shadow Blade, it's actually not as bad. Because all he's got to do is just walk up, level death, doom. There's no second wave of protection. So he'll be fine. The Wraith King's got a second life. At least he's got... like, actually, what is Pasha... okay, so Pasha's got 2.9k. If it was going to be an armlet, he probably would have already got pieces of that. An armlet doesn't really work against NiP either. So, like, I was joking... well, not really joking. I was actually semi-seriously about the Doombringer and going the Radiance build. But I'm wondering if it's worthwhile Pasha doing that now. It's... he still needs survivability. So I wouldn't be against also doing, like, the Chinese kind of style, like the 32-minute SMY, which they kind of like to do. But it's... but you could try the Halbert. Halbert wouldn't be a bad choice up against the Weaver, but with Weaver's current farm rate, getting a Monkey King bar isn't really too much of an ask.
Exactly.
So the evasion won't really last for that long.
And then you've got Nature's Prophet, who is not adverse to going Monkey King bar either. He can get that relatively quickly.
Yeah. So the Veno will be the only one who doesn't, but he does his damage through Nova. So, bump, bump, bump.
Like, the Radiance would give you pushing power, but the miss chance against the heroes really wouldn't be there for an extended period of time.
Yeah.
It'd be all about that Radiance burn.
It's the burn. It's the burn to keep him back. Because the Ancient Apparition will... he won't even struggle with this. Once he gets his axe, he's got more than enough life. The Veno... like, normally it was that thing which is like, oh, yeah, the Veno's really weak. Then he's got Nagged Imcept, and you're like, well, actually, I've got 1,500 life, practically. What are you going to do? Poppy was saying that himself. Like, when they, when he got given the Aghanim's upgrade from Eternal Envy, he was walking around as a weak Venomancer. Then he got the Aghanim's Scepter upgrade and realized he can just stand throughout all the fights. And what are you going to do against him? Like, you fight him, you get Nova'd, you get Galed, you get poisoned up, you just die a very slow, painful, horrible death. So I'm going to go again. Everyone has managed to get themselves back inside the game. It's just a rough world, really, for Vega. NiP have everything they need, but you can also understand why NiP are dragging this out. Because they understand if they have a really, really bad fight, the TA can get that BKB up with the Blink Dagger and the Death Zone, the momentum's going to start to increase. They're still going to be respectful of the Doombringer, what the Clockwork offers to a fight, the Dazzle, who can ensure they can't just get the instant pick off. Like, that's the big thing. And if their Ice Blast doesn't connect, or the Nova doesn't connect, they don't actually have a lot more to keep battling Vega with. So they don't have this game in the bag by any stretch of the imagination. They've definitely got a bag.
If they screw up their ultimates, NiP are heavily reliant on the Weaver doing damage.
Yep.
And that was like the one scenario I was talking about where the refresher on Limp could potentially keep them, give them that sort of fallback. You know, if they do mess up, they've got the second poison over just in case.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they do have a pretty good XP advantage right now, sitting around 7,500, 8,000. Sorry, gold advantage, but their XP advantage isn't that massive. You know, Vega have done a very good job in keeping, especially the Doombringer, up to par.
It's because Solo has just been running around farming wherever he possibly can. Like, the NiP were looking to push or battle on another lane, and then he moved up with, like, the Dazzle, and they were just farming up inside the raiding inside the Dire jungle. The TA got as much as she can from the bottom. I remember when I first started casting Dota 2, that was. And I had this saying, because I was a big StarCraft fan, back before the game was dead. And I was talking about like the fact you got limited resources on the map for a certain period of time. As how many times you can claim those resources when they're able to spawn, or able to claim them before they get taken out by your opponent. And there was a very similar kind of thing, like you gain the materials, there's nothing left, and then all of a sudden you win the game because you've got more materials. And it's the same kind of thing with what Vega's doing. The Doombringer, like, Vega are trying to make the most out of the Dire jungle. And then they get as much as they possibly can out of their own jungle, all their own ancients, while NiP are attacking them on all sides. But they're still moving up, they're still finding resources, they're still finding things to work with. And then NiP gives them opportunities to fight. That's why the clockwork gets picked. You jump, you kill, the TA goes for a bling dagger. You jump, you kill, you get back, and you just rinse and repeat.
And that's why the clockwork has a Midas as well. He's getting closer and closer to his Aghanim Scepter.
If he gets that Ags, NiP are in a lot of trouble, because even more liberal with the hook, and they just keep jumping, and time again, they'll go ham. And you're basically running two Midases on Vega. Doom, because of Devour. And Midas over on the clockwork.
And then there's that point in time when we look at, you know, we mentioned the Radiance on Wraith King. This could equally be a BKB that he's saving up for.
Yeah.
Even though he isn't buying up the components for it, sometimes we like people just to go for that BKB straight up.
I'm wondering what else he can get, though. Because he could try and go for the control. He could try and go for something more like Bash or Abyssal.
There aren't many options. I think it's BKB or Radiance.
Yeah.
Like, what else do you really go for? AC is okay, but I think you need to tank up more before that. And you don't really see, like, Heart or Satanic. Mjolnir is more of a later game item.
BKB's not enough for you either. Like, I'm really not liking that.
Like, if...
You got to go for the jump kill. Like, Vega's got to go for... Because if you go for BKB and you're already gunked up by Venomancer...
That's the thing. I think you wait for your second life to BKB. Like, you jump in, you bait all the spells, get Ice Blasted, Veno altered, and then when you come back to life, the BKB gives you the freedom to dodge things like Gale, Splinter Blast, Cold Feet, things like that, and you can actually fight into them.
True, and then you can work on like NiP, like if they do try and do like the big wombo combo of abilities, and there's nothing left for the Wraith King when he comes back up. That was always the problem when you go up against Wraith King. You need to have that sustained damage, but you have this thing called a Weaver.
Nah.
And that is sustained damage. Even by the time Wraith King respawns, you're going to have Gale back off cooldown for the Venomancer. He could actually go completely immortal and go into something more like an Octarine Core after that Lincoln Sphere. And then there's no way you kill a Venomancer during a fight. Like, you pop your ulti and you're just regenerating.
You're flashing with the rainbow lights.
Yeah, it's so OP. Like, it's so OP. Funny thing is, you could do a very similar thing with the Chikiro as well.
It's so good with Warlock, the Fatal Bonds with Octarine Core. You just, like, permanently.
Oh, that's just so douchey.
It's flashing lights.
I love it with the offlane Jakiro. After you get your initiation, you go into Nocturne Call, and because you've got so much strength behind the hero, and if the macro pie is in a half decent position, you're back to full life after you take like even burst damage. Like, it's just straight back up to full life. For those who are watching my stream, I tried that out. The offlane Jakiro Nocturne Call. It was amazing. All right, we're going to go again. Hello, hello, hello. Would you believe it?
TPing out to safety.
No, no, no. Well, that's going to happen, yeah.
Oh, no.
But it's what's over on Limp. He actually did it. He actually got himself the Lotus Orb.
Oh, wow.
After we talked about how ineffective the reflection's going to be. Because if Doom dies, you don't really care. As long as he gets his abilities off beforehand. He actually dooms himself, and he just regenerates through the Doom. With Scorched Earth already triggered.
So he counters the Doom himself.
Yeah, but I almost feel like this is... What breaks first if you put the Lotus Orb over on Era? The Lincolns, I believe is this way, but
it
correct me if I'm wrong.
It blocks and reverses.
But it doesn't do it at the same time. Right? So the Lincolns will trigger, and then it will reverse the second ability. Correct?
Wait, what do you mean? If he throws...
So if you... Okay. Scenario. Era's walking around right now with his Lincoln Sphere.
Mm-hmm.
Lotus Orb is put on top of him. Doomringer walks up to him. He level deaths.
It'll bounce back to level death and block it.
At the same time.
Yeah.
So it doesn't bounce back... It doesn't break the Lincolns with level death and then... Like, bounce the Doom back. Because that's the way I think it would work, right?
No, because they both apply at the same time. I'm pretty certain about this. Like, if you Laguna Blade someone, it blocks the Laguna Blade onto you and reverses it onto the Lina. With Lincolns and Lotus.
Okay.
I'm like 99% sure about that. I could be entirely wrong.
I'm not a mechanic guy myself, but that's just... I know, logically it's the way I would think that ability would function, but I'm all about asking questions and finding answers. So someone tweet me at @turby1dota, let me know. I'm trusting Durka for now. I trust Durka for now. Just one of those small little interactions, because they both act as shields. So it's like, which shield procs first? Because if it is the Lotus Orb and it reflects, because you don't take the damage when you get hit by Lotus, right? So it just reflects it straight away.
Wait, Lotus Orb reflect. You take Lotus Orb is you take and reflect. So like if
okay.
You have just
in that case, yeah, it should. Yeah, it should be both at the same time. You're 100% right, Durka. It should be both at the same time. You are right.
I hope so.
No, you're right. You're right because if you're gonna take the damage, it's gonna reflect it at the same time. So yeah, it's so you actually, yeah, you stop the effect from happening. While still reflecting it. God, I'm sorry, I'm challenging it so much tonight. So we get to reset up our game after a couple of delays. But don't worry, everyone! All it does is just make sure that the second series is going to be even closer to the first. Because the second game of this series won't begin until 2230 CET. No matter what happens. As we do simulcast it out over on Danish TV. Pasha, TP out. Well, there goes your reincarnation. Blinks back off cooldown, but he can't get it off in time.
The gale so well timed from Limp.
It was in mid-flight on top of Pasha's head, cancelling that TP. But now solo and no one, they add the pressure up mid, pushing to the tier 2 tower and forcing the Wyvern back. It's actually really freaking, like, it's stupid in a way. The fact that Vega are able to out-split push a Nature's Prophet with just the quick push of a Doombringer. Because he's being, it's like, Solo's being so confident because of the Shadowblade. He's moving aggressively across the map, pushing and then hunting. But now they definitely know where NiP are coming.
The hard push in bottom lane, yeah. With yep. All their ultis back up as well. NiP in a good spot here. But they TP back, they don't need to force the issue, just get themselves away.
Goodbye wave. Clockwork Rocket as well as Shadow Wave.
Yep.
NiP, it actually doesn't matter how big they get with their creep wave. It's too easy for Vega to mop up. I'm still looking at this Wraithkin's money too. There
still
goes
not
the Wyvern.
Anything.
Hanskin having real issues tonight.
Still on 3,200 gold. Wraithkin, come on.
It's gotta be the Relic. Right, it's either gonna be a straight BKB or it's the Radiance build. But the longer this goes, the more ineffective the Radiance is going to be. This one,
Oh, and for the guys arguing about refresher on Venomancer, it's for the second stage of the fight. Like, it definitely does have its merits. There's a reason you pick refresher on Ags Veno especially. Because Vega, they've got a very good sort of two-cycle team fight. They come in. I know it doesn't stack. That's not the point to get two ultimates at the same time. It's for when Vega reinitiate and get the second ulti out.
And your duration is only 16 seconds.
Yeah, exactly.
So if you can keep that, like, continuously on, like, you get like, your 32 seconds worth of Nova, you're going to take out all of Vega's life. Like, there's no way that you can stay on the front lines. TA will never have refraction up. Yeah, I can understand the merits of it, too. It just feels a little overkill in my mind for the Venomancer.
Oh, yeah. No way I was saying it's the best item to go for.
Yeah.
See what it's useful for.
All right, now I can get flamed for the Lotus Orb thing.
Oh, no, there's already a Reddit thread flaming me for saying that Refresher is an item you can buy on Venomancer.
What?
Yeah.
Holy crap, guys, get a life.
Oh my god, you can buy a magic wand on a Weaver. No, you're not allowed to do that.
You know, it's hilarious when someone makes a thread like that, you think, and they're sitting there, and they're just going, people are going to back me up and say, this is really freaking stupid. And it's like, yeah, how do you think stupid concepts came up? How many times would you go into a pub game and go, Queen of Pain support is a really stupid idea? I think you probably say 9 times out of 10, Queen of Pain support's a really stupid idea. Maybe even a higher percentage than that.
That's the thing,
Alliance will do it, and everyone's going to accept it. Dota has always been...
It's dynamic.
Yeah, it's always been shaped by people who question the norm. Like, if you're thinking about a refresher on a Venomancer, does your team fight work around this? Like... just having these rando thoughts is what allows you to develop and actually understand Dota deeper.
That's the thing.
If, like, you ask these questions, we just ask on a live stream where we're going to get judged.
Like, explaining the merits of an item isn't saying it is the item he's going for, the best item that he should be doing. It's just saying that this is an option.
Yep.
He could do this, and this is what he'd get out of it.
Yeah, but you say something silly, people are going to jump on it. It's just the fact of
King's
life.
Buying a rapier, Toby.
That's definitely it. Okay, guys, confirmed. Now, new Reddit thread. Does Radiance work on a Wraith King when you're at the 30-minute mark? You know, if he actually had a mana style, Octarine Core, BTs, if he was Alchemist, maybe it would be a great idea.
He can pretend to be. He can pretend to be Alchemist, pretending to be Naga. He can buy Radiance, Manta, Octarine Core, and the Wraith King. That's the play.
I always just want to say stupid shit for the rest of the night, just to piss people off. You know, there was one guy that actually complained about what is being tweeted out when he willingly follows me. You complain about what's being tweeted out, then just stop following.
Simple.
But he's just like, can you just stop tweeting about this? Or can you just stop following? Seema, very lucky to survive through this. He actually waited next to the tier 1 tower. Okay, well, that pause, and we're just gonna... Eerie just resumes.
Yeah, the admin said they've got no more pause time left.
Okay. The seeds are fortune. So it's a hard life for NiP. They have to micro the Wyvern. Not actually really that difficult when you think about it. Like, the timings are going to be rough because it's a 4-star over on Hanskin. But when you're running an Ancient Apparition, normally he just sits at the back of the fight anyway and waits to throw out the abilities. So it's going to be rough for a couple of times, but not too critical. Something more like a Weaver who has to get that exact timing. That might be a little bit more difficult. And you can still buy items when Hanskin's able to reconnect in bit by bit. Solo. Oh, wow. That's, yeah. That's a lot of damage. He just built a BK. He's got his BKB. The Ice Blast coming in. Solo. He felt it. He knew it. That was a disturbance on the bottom lane. It was like a million people cried out in terror, and he stayed away from the Ice Blast.
Mag is super far up this lane.
He's got Seema behind him. They're really trying to get like aggressive on one of the lanes, so then you can just push elsewhere, and that's what TA is doing. Like, TA is now finally finished the full BKB, can TP back at any moment. But because this pressure is being applied, NiP are so cautious. They don't want to push down a lane, because what do you do? Like, Hans King comes up to the top. They're staring down the tier 2 tower. He's going to Arctic Burn, jump in behind, and then they mass TP. But if no one's quick enough for this, okay, the Ice Blast, the TP in, okay, he's dead.
Like, the haste run away is not enough, man.
No. He was actually going to tick out anyway. His only option was to TP straight away because the curse was already used. So there was no other way for them to do, like, they just had to damage him down.
Try and jump mid.
I think so.
Nah.
Ward mission.
Can't go for
Observer and Sentry down. Hanskin doesn't have anything. Well, then again, so yeah, that is Hanskin. But he's moving like he's DC'd. Seema, successful TP out.
TA has her BKB now, and that's a huge deal here against NiP. Wraith King has the Relic, so he's going into the Radiance, or the Rapier. But oh, we're not 100% sure yet. Probably the Radiance, though.
He could also go Abyssal.
He could do so. But more importantly, level 16 isn't far away. Like, the level 3 ultimate is huge for him.
Yeah. The upside about going for something like an Abyssal over on Pasha is the fact they then have the potential to kill the Venomancer off before he can get that Nova out. That's the only reason why I'm thinking more about the Abyssal Blade than I'm thinking more about the Radiance. Because the Radiance Burn's going to be nice to really piss off, like, Nature's Prophet. Because he can't keep an army of trees up. Ancient Apparition's always going to keep his distance anyway, and Wyvern's going to regenerate everyone else up. So I'm kind of thinking more about that. But the fact you go the Relic first does put into a little bit more, like, question if it's going to be Abyssal or Radiance. It's probably going to be Radiance.
So they have BKB Doom, BKB TA, Aghanim's on Clockwork. This is where Vega really have that really strong period of play where they can blink in, find pickoffs as long as they don't get wiped. They've got some good multi-cycle team fights, but Yunus TP straight in.
He goes up here, Mag. Actually, four-staffing, they're pretty far out. And then they four-staff up Pasha. Remember, he's still got reincarnation. It's a perfect curse. Actually catching out Seema as well. The Ice Blast will arrive, and Dazzle will dive back in base. There's no way he can survive through that one. They kill Pasha over twice.
Where's Mag?
And in fact, Dazzle, yeah, he's already down for the count.
Mag can TP. What's he up to?
Creep skipping? Maybe?
Just waiting, biding his time.
He can rock it from behind and make him look. Yeah, he's courier, four staff attack. He actually snipes at the courier.
Sneaky devil.
He waited for it.
But that's devastating. Honestly, you've lost your level 2 reincarnation. You've lost your Wraith King, and this is the point at which I thought Vega would be able to group up as 5, maybe spread themselves out to defend a tier 3, and win a fight potentially. This was their chance. And now they're losing Rax.
Yeah. They haven't lost it yet, however.
Oh, it's gone. Right. Like, okay. With a Desolator on the Weaver, there's no chance of survival.
Okay, yeah, I can agree.
Maybe even double lanes here. The fact that Wraith King doesn't have reincarnation.
Is Seema dead?
What's he hit by?
That's an Ag-Zolt? It's an Aghanim. It's only level 2, though. But he hit by the Wrath of Nature at the same time.
Oh, they're going bot lane.
He's so... If he wasn't 100% alive, he was dead. Hookshot, that's a long way out. Already on the Doom target, which is Limp. And Mag, he wants to go for more. Hunt is going to Cold Embrace Limp up. The Blinkets available, but there's no reincarnation available for the Wraith King. He's still not level 16 yet. And TA, well, out comes your BKB. Hanskin, the Hookshot flies in. Limp will get a really good ulti, but the BKB will protect solo for the moment. At least from the damage output, Seema may not be so lucky. He's got the Shallow Grave available.
Oh, there comes
and
Jonas.
He's actually got a bug on him. He's just going to die anyway. The Ice Blast too far out of position. Solo ticking so quickly. Down for the count. Mag is on 60 life back in the mid lane. So the Venno did end up dying. But Vega hold onto their bottom racks and they keep the TA alive. So more items coming his way. And the Wraith King did finish up the Radiance. Can I just say I called that like 20 minutes ago?
You need a Reddit thread to praise. Shout out to Toby!
Yeah.
Calling the Radiance Wraith King.
Love me, say that you love me.
Oh, wow, see you,
okay,
buddy.
He got hit, firstly directly by no one, and then two by Sideblaze, but Era with no one being hit so hard like this, you need the Dazzle alive for the Shallow Grave. He actually dodges the bugs. The Ice Blast Aghanim Scepter will ensure the kill over on no one, but you lost your Nature's Prophet for all of that. Era's on the run out of here. There's no Doom available, but Hanskin having to be forced up out of here. Mag has Hookshot off cooldown. Someone's got to stick around to ensure the kill over on Hanskin. They can claim that, and now Hookshot forward over on Era. Doesn't dodge the Gale, but Liz being pushed back out. He has the Lotus Orb down, but they just have enough damage. And Solo, well, there it is. He actually gets doomed up by himself with a Lotus Orb Reflection. He cannot level death. He can't do anything. He's just running up. The Seal Kid's going to ulti Solo down. Solo doesn't want to give up on this, but Lim, he doesn't even die. You might actually have another death, however. That's on Unison Farm. Nature's Prophet just died back. He tried to force out the middle lane. They'll take out the Tier 3 tower. The Pasha and Seema are on the defense. So is the Templar Assassin. Without the Weave, without the Prophet, they can't keep this push going, however, and Limp is too low. So Vega will just try and mop up the mess that NiP has made in their home.
This is where things start getting a little bit spooky for NiP, because they're losing heroes pretty rapidly here against the BKBs, and the jump in from Vega, it's pretty strong. Seema now has a Glimmer Cape. How much net worth lead have they lost, Toby?
Everything. Actually, everything. Vega have their first lead in what is probably 30 minutes in the game.
Oh, for XP, yeah.
For XP? Oh, for gold, it's like...
It's still NiP favored.
Yeah, it's still 10,000, but you've taken out a top lane of Rax. You've taken out two tier 3 towers, and what's been taken in return? Like, that tier 1 tower still exists on the bottom lane. You haven't lost a single tier 2 tower. NiP, this 10,000 net worth advantage, 3/4 of that comes from buildings. But of course, they still have it. So, yep. Roshan's probably going to be the next critical point. That might actually be exactly where Vega can win the fight. But they have to have... Like, they got the TA trap inside the pit. Is there a gem? There's a gem over on Mag. So they got the detection from him. They might want to get rid of this Observer Ward that's sitting in the top lane. This thing right here scouts out all the movements of Vega. So Vega cannot surprise NiP at the moment because they understand who's going to be on that top lane defending it.
So, Toby, you know how we wanted an epic long game? So that we'd have no gap in between the two games for the series?
Well, it's not epically long as far as the time it goes, but we have had a couple of pauses which have extended it. It's cool. I love this game. This game can still go either way. So, yes. Yes, Durka.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we didn't need a Spectre or a Medusa or a Naga or anything like that talking about.
That is actually what we were talking about.
He's caught in the cogs and Mag. Has to force himself away.
Okay, he's away.
And now back in again. And now away. And back in. Solo wants
Lim, Mag's on TP. This is a gem. A hook shot's down. And then TP's away to safety. He'll survive. He's ticking. That's Gale, Nova, and Poison Sting. He is so low.
He's going to die.
And Mag is
no!
just barely alive.
20 HP.
He's hiding in the trees. The Ice Blast is on cooldown for 8 more seconds. That's why Mag's also down here, just in case that cooldown's a little bit lower. Solo, a double damage rune, attacks him towards Limp, wants to beat him down once more. Even if he just kills off Limp here, it's still worth it. But Solo, gonna get cursed, maybe not so worth it anymore. The Ice Blast, BKB is up here from the Doombringer, but he cannot stand his ground. The Wyvern will find the kill, and the Venomancer will end up surviving. 71 seconds without a Doombringer.
According to the combat log, Clockwork went down to 1 health.
It depends what he's being affected by.
Went down to 1 health from the Poison Nova, but because the Poison Sting damage came in a little bit later, he healed up enough to not tick over and die.
Because Nova can't send you critical.
Yeah. So he dropped to 1 HP, healed enough in the interval between Poison Nova damage and Gale / Poison Sting damage, and okay, that was close.
That's just luck.
I had to double check.
That's what that is. That's just pure luck. God. Okay, the bottom lane. Vega almost have to be the aggressors here. Like, yeah, Nova is up, Era's on the front line, but you're without a Doombringer for 28 seconds. No one's able to get a little bit of Psyblade build damage because of the Plague Ward that was placed down. They get rid of the creep wave pretty quickly, too. And the top lane's pushing in, a Limp just goes ham. Jumps forward. Instantly, you see that Lotus Orb effect come up on him. Hanskin, be controlled by the hookshot of Mag. He's going to force up himself back inside the base again. He can hookshot in just a moment. Era time-lapsing himself away, but that Ice Blast, it's going to end up killing off Pasha. They actually had the Wrath of Nature. No one, they can't stop the Shatter. He's down for 106 seconds. That could actually be the game right there. The fact you've lost the Templar Assassin. Yes, Doom is back off cooldown.
But they have to defend two lanes at once.
Yeah, they're being attacked from Sumi. But that's a jump shot. He actually gets four inside the cogs. The Doom is down again. But again, the Lotus Orb. It reflects the damage back out again. Sealkin's so low. Ear is the one who's being controlled. He will tick out right now. And that's able to be it. Well, yeah, with a buyback from the Wraith King. Dazzle will end up surviving through this through the Plague Wars. The Poison Sting, he's able to Glimmer Cape himself up, so the damage is negligible. Mag hook shotting out, catching out Limp for a moment. The Cold Embrace locks him in position, but Mag trying to go to work. Hanskin earning himself back up again. Hookshot's back off cooldown in 1 second time, but what can Mag do? He can rock it for the moment. He needs to hookshot himself to the dire creep wave. He can't do it. He takes out a ward and then ends up dying, dropping the gem behind him. But Limp, he's turning around for another fight. The middle lane got taken out while all that was going on. They've just got to get through the range ranks to force out the Megas. Unison Farmer, Limp Solo, back to the front lines. There is your protection, but the Lotus Orb won't do enough. Curse will do more, but Solo, under the cover of BKB, the hook shot out. Unison Farm's in trouble. He's going to get stunned up. This is actually him having himself another death, and no buyback available. A triple kill arriving for Solo. They are 2.5 lanes of Rakdos down. The range ranks and 199 life. The NiP cannot put the nail in the Vega coffin.
And even Limp bought back for that as well. He tried to TP, had BOTs, TP'd to a creep down in bottom lane. It got killed. Just before he landed, he had his poison over back up. He could have gone in there and potentially wiped them and ended the game. But the creep dies mid TP, so just walk into the Roche pit and start setting up camp over there.
He's doing it though, right on top of the TA trap. They know where Limp is. If they're quick enough without the Nature's Prophet, they could move out and try and find this kill. The Assault Cuirass is now done for Solo. So these team fights just became a little bit harder for NiP. It's both Weave as well as AC effects kicking in for Vega so they can survive a long time, at least up against the damage of the Weaver. The Weaver's also got a Talisman of Agents, so they keep on going. The TA trap's there, and Solo, he walks straight past the Shuriken, Weaver. But now it's Vega's turn. Look at the damage output. They're going to take it. Who gets the Aegis the Immortal? Denied? No. TA will pick up the Aegis the Immortal.
And Solo gets the cheese.
Okay. They've got even more to work with. Solo's got buyback, and so does the Templar Assassin. So does no one.
Do you five-man mid now?
No.
You've got three options, right?
You wait.
The YOLO plays the five-man mid and just try and, you know, take the fight to NiP. And see what happens, because you know that they're running out of buybacks. They've got, one on Weaver, one on AA. Or you go back and just secure your farm and push out the two lanes which don't have racks anymore, the mid and top, which it looks like they're going to be doing now. Because Aegis and Cheese at this point, it secures you farm on the Templar Assassin to get you into that finished Daedalus. You've got BKB now in the clockwork. The Wraith King has a Moonshard out of freaking nowhere.
Yeah!
But I still feel he needs a BKB.
He kind of does, but This is the Vega playmat. Like, the BKB isn't necessary if he does exactly what you were talking about almost 20 minutes ago, where you just have Pasha blink in, soak up everything you've got. The Radiance Burn's going to be there. He inflicts as much damage as possible that they actually have to deal with him. And this gives space for Solo as well as no one to just pump out the damage to NiP. And NiP have to wait this out. Like, NiP might have the inkling to go in and try and take out the range racks. If they do this, however, they're fighting into the Aegis of the Immortal. The better choice for them is to wait another 4.5 minutes. Mag, get the hell out of there. Four stuff. He's got enough speed.
He's putting the fear of clock into Hanskin right now. Every single time you see him, hookshot in, cogs, battery assault. Hanskin knows, okay, I can Arctic Burn, four staff away, and I can escape, I'm fine. It's just the fact that he has to Cold Embrace, heal himself up, and always be very wary that it may not always just be the clockwork. There could be someone behind him coming in, a Doom, a Templar Assassin, a Wraith King. Mag is this conduit. He is the starter, the opener for the damage. We still have to worry, though, about this Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, for Vega. Refresher and Octarine for Unison Farm. So, not only is it the life coming back to him during the fight, it's the fact that his Refresher Orb has a cooldown of 146 seconds. So going for that double ulti combo, we talked about what happened with Wyvern when he would attack, a 2 minute cooldown for him. Now you've got the same amount of cooldown over on an ultimate.
The next prop
to have a double one. Solo's in trouble, he has to get himself out, but The ulti flies out from Limp, Sol is going to BKB. There's no TP available. He's going to actually use the cheese already, and this buys time for the Templar Assassin to arrive in from the back. Hanskin actually curses on the TA, but Mag hookshots even further. The Doom is over on Limp, so there's no more follow-up from him, but no one being attacked down by Ira. The Shallow Grave will give time for Vega to keep fighting with his Templar Assassin. Ira doesn't have an easy finish, and Pasha to the front lines. They do actually get the hookshot forward, sending up Ira. The cogs push back. There's two heroes down for NiP. Vega are fighting this one. No one, however, brought down by the creep wave, but the Aegis Immortal gives him a secondary life. Limp, that stun, a fraction of a second too late. He's able to TP himself back home. Meanwhile,
it's all
speaking
for
of home, everything's in trouble. You've managed to take out the range racks, and your middle lane's been pressured in so hard.
Even though Weaver doesn't have buyback here, like in any other game, it'd be like, oh god, Weaver doesn't have buyback. Vega, they could go and end the game potentially.
Yep.
But 47 minutes in, 55 seconds is nothing when you've got a Nature's Prophet doing this.
And that's your Aegis and cheese burned.
Yep.
So because of that, now you're sitting at a point where you can't ensure yourself that you win the next fight. And NiP don't feel pressured to wait anymore. Like, if they want to go, they can just go.
Throw bodies.
But the TA has a buyback available. I'm wondering, too, if this is going to be that point where TA just... she can't go Arabia because there's not enough time to farm up the money. But you need to basically pop NiP so quickly. And it's got to come from a physical damage. It can't come from the Doom anymore because you're running double Lotus Orb as well as having that Lincoln Sphere. I think there's another Lincoln Sphere arriving for the Ancient Apparition. He can double coat, unless he's thinking about for a pressure orb. He could double coat the Weaver with Lincoln Sphere. Limp jumping forward. No one. That Meld Strike hits so hard. The hook shots forward, but no one. He's dead. The Ice Blast and Shallow Grave won't keep him enough. He has to do as much damage as possible in this period of time. But Seema also got controlled. Ira finds the kill on him. The TA will buy back. Mag is chasing down Limp, but he can't finish the job.
Look at Yunus.
He is. Okay. Pasha is now coming out for the kill. The Yunus of Farm is going down. He's going for the trade-off. That was the play. But TA came back to defend it. So the Wraith King is down for 104 seconds fully. You get a buyback on the Nature's Prophet. TA is regenerating as quick as she can. And now you actually get that magical Octarine Core on a Venomancer. He's immortal. Like, he's actually immortal. If he hits three or four heroes with that ulti of his, he is immortal. And we get another Vladimir's offering up. This time it's over on the Doombringer. There was one over on the Dazzle, but they're not staying alive long enough. The Ice Blast, no one. He gets out of range.
Okay, Vega, this is the last stand. You need no one to just go and one-hit crit someone.
Basically. He's doing 1800s on the crit, but he's being attacked by so many creeps. The Megas are moving forward. Ira's going to take out the tower. One more attack from the creep, but just punches it down. And then Limp. There's your jump in. That's your big hit. Limp, the Lotus Orb. He dies almost instantly. That attack damage from the TA is just too much. They've still got the crease pushing forward, but Mag hookshots into Ira, isolates him out, but he's got to force staff himself
into
away.
The ice blast
will actually kill him. Hits him just on the tip. Solo is still standing his ground. Ira moves back closer. Solo has this Doom off cooldown 22 seconds time. Mag has to buy back as well. You're up against Megas. You need every man on the field. 30 seconds until Wraith King is alive again. The catapult's also causing some problems. TA having to regenerate back inside the base. So Solo moves forward to get rid of the catapults. But they've got so much damage when you combine the Pack Wolf aura as well as having that Daedalus attacking TA.
The Sideblade Splash, yeah.
Yep. It just hurts so much. There goes your creep wave, a hookshot a long way down. Actually locking out Unison Farm, but no one. That's a big curse. The Shallow Grave and Ice Blast are coming, and no one's going to get himself far enough away. He can't do so. He turns through the damage. Can't do it. 2 minutes on the sidelines. Solo's being attacked.
The fortress is
being attacked. Ira will actually end up going down. You're right, with Pasha back towards the living. But Ira, he just buybacks and time lapses in. The fortress will drop, and that is going to be it. NiP. They knew it was going to be difficult. They didn't think it was going to be that bloody tough.
They had it, though. It turned into more of a nail biter than we expected, but they had it. It was that key moment when they had three BKBs on Vega, where suddenly it's a lot more difficult to get those big Wombo combo ultis down and actually onto the targets you wanted. Vega played very well against that. I feel that the draft from NiP was very strong. Seems like something that they've played around with a lot.
Uh-huh.
The four-roll Doom, not a fan.
In this situation,
I'm not a fan.
I'm actually okay with it for what it ended up doing. Like,
I feel if you're picking Wraith King there,
it's... Yeah, the Wraith King for me is probably more of the questionable pickup, not the Doombringer.
Yeah.
Because Doom is always going to function. I don't think you can ever say, wow, you lost because you picked Doom. It's not a possibility. But with the Wraith King pickup, he didn't really bring enough, but you could also understand what he wanted to do. Like, it's that second life, it's that second fight. So everything which Vega drafted actually worked against, like, the counter heroes. It was like this counter pick versus counter pick kind of play. But the issue was still that Ancient Apparition hitting those ultis, which just caused Vega to not be able to sustain during the fight. And that's where they lost out. The Doombringer, who can't sustain. The Tia, who can't stay alive long enough. The Clockwork did his job. The Dazzle tried to do as much as he possibly could, but you're fighting up against an Aghanim's ulti AA. You just can't do it. So, Ninjas in Pajamas, they'll end up taking out game number one against Vega, and this keeps their top two slot hopes alive. The defense final is still an option for them, even though they did have their 1-1 result earlier tonight. And we'll get to have a break, Durka.
20 minutes?
Roughly. It's probably going to be about 15 minutes before we come back, guys, because we're very close to half hour. So stay tuned.
We start at 22:40 tonight.
22:40? Okay, yes. We have a 15-minute break then. Grab yourself a beverage, Joel. We will be back after this break.
I said good day, sir!